Hello, I'm Andrew Kelly from Bristol Ideas and director of our biennial Festival of the Future City. We've long been concerned and discussed often in our work the damaging effects of our over-centralised country. This is not just a political problem. There are major economic, social and cultural problems too. For too long, we have seen areas outside London and the South East decline, people and places left behind. Levelling up has become a core part of the political rhetoric, especially since the 2019 general election. But action on levelling up has been limited. As journalist Sam Bright says in his new book, Fortress London, Why We Need to Save the Country from Its Capital, We Need New Ideas. Sam, thank you for joining us.
Pleasure.
You're from Huddersfield, you've worked for the BBC, you've written for many publications and are now investigative editor at Byline Times. What has this and your education taught you about London and regional inequality?
Well, I'd say certainly journalism is one of the most concentrated and centralised professions, and quite damagingly so, I think, because of its combination with low wages. So you'll obviously see a vast concentration of jobs in the financial sector in the City of London. But at least those people can afford to live in the capital. I think journalism is one of the professions where you need to be highly educated, you need to be highly skilled, but the industry has suffered in recent years. And so many young journalists find it difficult to break into the fortress, to break into the capital and find work. And I think that means invariably that it's those with the capital, with a stake in London, who can perhaps live with their parents during early career opportunities, or who are just, you know, have family wealth, the bank of mum and dad to rely upon. Those are the people that are able to break into this quite socially exclusive profession. And I think that's been borne out in media coverage of certain events in recent years. Obviously, Brexit was a big one that the media didn't see coming. And I'm sure there'll be plenty more in the future, because although there's been some efforts to try and diversify journalism, unfortunately, certainly from my experience, it seems as though region is still lacking in that diversification effort. Obviously, we've seen laudable efforts to sort of take the BBC to new places. Media City is a remarkable endeavour in many ways, based in Salford. Obviously, Channel 4 has opened a new headquarters in Leeds. But compared to the vast scale of the newspapers and the broadcasters and the BBC and new broadcasting house in central London, these efforts are actually quite marginal in terms of redistributing jobs to other parts of the country. So on the whole, yeah, it's a pretty bleak picture from my point of view. And I've been one of the fortunate ones who's come from a small town in the north and has managed with a tremendous amount of luck to make my way in the first decade of my career.
I want to come back to journalism. Let's look at some more detail in the book to begin with. You commissioned a special opinion poll on attitudes to London and the regions. A big headline figure for me was 70% of respondents from all UK nations and regions, including 59% of Londoners, believe that London has been given preferential treatment by government since 2005. What other key points did you find from this research?
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously, like you mentioned, I think it's staggering that people in London do recognise actually the imbalances that exist within the country and are concerned about them. I think one, not necessarily from the opinion polling that I undertook, but from some research from party political polling that I saw that complements this, is the fact that Labour Party members in the South of England place regional inequality very high up in terms of their orders of concern. And now this, you know, the Labour Party is known for many things in recent years in terms of tackling injustice, but I think it's fair to say that regional inequalities of not being high up in terms of the institutions of the Labour Party, in terms of the Labour Party leadership. It's not been the top of the agenda, which is one of the reasons why we saw the red wall seats flipped to the Conservatives in 2019. But the fact is that Labour Party members themselves really consider regional inequality to be a formative inequality in modern Britain. So I'd say that both in terms of the opinion polling that I commissioned and the other opinion polling that I saw from other sources confirmed that there's sort of a disjuncture between the institutions of power in this country, whether that's Whitehall or whether that's the political parties, and what individuals, what you might call the silent majority, really believe about regional inequality. There's widespread concern, not just in the north, not just in the traditional areas where you might think they'd have grievances about regional inequalities, but actually in those places that have benefited to some extent from these regional inequalities in recent years. And my book's, trying to reframe the argument, really. It's not just about the north-south divide. It's about London and, to a wider extent, the southeast and everywhere else. You know, as you'll know, the southwest has its own acute regional problems. I'm sure we'll come on to that.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things which, in terms of wider context setting, certainly some of the work we've done and reading your book, is there's still this strong attachment to a place where people come from, but it's undermined by the declines that we've seen under investment, but also by people moving away from the place to get work elsewhere. And I think, going to London is one of those options for people, which means that a lot of younger people leave the place. It's not something which Bristol suffers particularly from, I would say, because we have high student retention, for example. But a lot of other places have this problem, don't they?
Yes, it's really interesting, actually, because people assume that London is rootless, that people in London are very flexible. They can live there, in David Goodhart's sort of dichotomy, they're anywheres rather than somewheres. They're very flexible, they're very mobile, etc. And they have a lack of attachment to place. But I don't think that's true. If you actually pay attention to what the conversation is in London, particularly amongst working class communities, it's a concern about gentrification. And that goes for all. I'm not talking about white working class. I'm talking about all working class groups. Gentrification is a massive problem in London. And that stems from a real attachment to the place and wanting to preserve a sense of community. And what I've argued in the past is that this concern stems from exactly the same problem in the north or, other parts of the country, in that they want to preserve their sense of community. And they're concerned about the fact that graduates have to leave in droves to the capital, and highly skilled people who've graduated from Russell Group universities flock down to London and then gentrify London. And so you've got a dual problem of these small towns in the north losing their sense of self because young people are fleeing, while creating this same problem in London through gentrification. And so my argument is if you solve the brain drain, you solve that problem in two places of the country, not just one.
And certainly gentrification is an issue which is of concern to Bristol communities, I would say. You worked on David Goodhart's book, am I right in saying that?
Yeah, I did. I researched it, yeah.
Yeah. We've had David speak a number of times, and I've always been struck by his work. Sometimes it's controversial, but I found it very useful in some of the work that we've been doing. You give the example of Port Talbot as one of the places where people have a strong attachment to the place, a certain generation, but then younger generations are moving away. Just talk us through that as a little case study.
Yeah, Port Talbot is a fascinating one, really, because of its industrial heritage and obviously the tartar steel plant on the banks of Port Talbot sort of loom over the town, and that's been the source of employment there for decades. And as we've all known, the headlines seem to pop up periodically that the plant's on the brink of collapse, and so there is this concern in Port Talbot that it just can't retain young people. And so you've got an extremely aging population in Port Talbot. You've got what would be classified in economic terms an unskilled population there. You've got young people who increasingly go to Cardiff for work, or more distantly to Bristol, and then to London. And you've got a relatively deprived part of the country, which means that you've got combined health problems in that area as well, on top of the area being quite demographically undiverse. So it's real. It's sort of the epitomization of, although you wouldn't classify it as a red wall area, but you know what we consider to be that sort of left behind part of the country, that was inclined towards Brexit and certainly has been inclined towards more radical political solutions in recent years. And one of the main new employers in the area is Amazon. So that's sort of the new dominant economic power in South Wales, are these massive Amazon factories, which don't offer the secure work that the steel industry used to. And the it's not particularly skilled work either, unless you're going into management. You don't necessarily need to have graduated at university to have to work in some of these factories. And so you've really got the divergence between the old declining industrial power of the steelworks and the new emerging sort of tech power of Amazon, and all the problems that come from that, particularly low wage, insecure employment. But you know, you've got job opportunities. So it's a real, yeah, Port Talbot is a real sort of tough nut to crack.
I also, when I was reading your book, was thinking about when I grew up, and I grew up in a place near Wolverhampton. And at that time, and for many years after, but now gone, the company Goodyear was a prime part of the town. It was a big employer. You know, played its part in supporting the football club and other charitable initiatives. And that's now gone as a company, to be replaced by, you know, who knows what, really, in terms of longer term employment opportunities. My father worked for Goodyear's most of his life, and my brother worked for Goodyear's virtually all of his working life. When they go, those can leave quite an impact on those places.
Yeah, definitely. And I mentioned in the book as well, my family has a history of working for the ICI in the north of England. You know, several of my family members work for the ICI. And you can see that sense still in them when I talk to them about it, of common, just employment providing a common existence for the town and a sense of identity that has now been fractured. And it's almost as though the town, I'm talking particularly of Widnes, where my family is from, and the town's in sort of a state of paralysis, waiting for the next boom to arrive, and hoping and believing that it deserves the next boom, because, you know, we're one of the wealthiest countries in the world, and we have one of the strongest cities in the world. And they see, you probably look over at Manchester as well and see Manchester's recent boom and think, why are we being left behind? You know, we were the sort of, you know, we carried the industrial revolution. You know, we had the wool on our backs, and you know, we were a manufacturing hub of the nation. And now, what have we got left? And I think this is largely missing from the Brexit conversation. We talk about these left behind areas, but we don't really, I don't think, understand emotionally what it means for these places to feel as though the modern economy is surging ahead and you're left static. That must be incredibly disorientating for people young and old in those places.
There's a new book coming out by Richard Vinen on Birmingham, which is being published by Alan Lane, interestingly, a big history of Birmingham. And reading a book like that, just as you've talked about Manchester there, reminds you of how significant some of these cities were at certain points in history, you know, particularly under, you know, the mayoral leadership of Chamberlain for a brief period, and the transformation of those places. It wasn't always like this, was it?
No, definitely not. I mean, that's the thing. Lots of the economic studies show that we were a lot more regionally unified at the start of the 20th century. Sorry, no, we weren't regionally unified at the start of the 20th century, because we had the end of the industrial era, and then we got steadily more unified during the sort of the interwar years. And since then, we've reverted back to an economic model and to regional inequalities that are more similar to the start of the 20th century than the middle part of the 20th century. So we've gone backwards. And I think the question is, how exactly has that happened? And why hasn't the government sought to prevent those inequalities from widening? And also, why now, after a series of political and economic convulsions, is it still not high up the political agenda to close these gaps? There seems to be a real lack of ideas, which is one of the reasons why this forum is so valuable, to actually address those questions, despite the fact that it's clearly at the top of people's minds.
Let's go through some of those inequalities. I'm glad, by the way, that you made the point about this is London and the South East. I've often felt that a city like Bristol has many advantages, huge advantages over other places, but still needs levelling up within the city. You know, it still has areas of deprivation. It still has issues around education. Some of the things you talk about in the book, it still has, as most places do, areas, issues around social mobility and so on, and inequality. Let's just talk about a few of these things. I mean, you talk about, in terms of education, how there was that very good programme called the London Challenge, but was done for London and then rolled out rather begrudgingly, I thought, and then stopped.
Mm. Yeah, the London Challenge was phenomenal in terms of its impact. I'm usually highly sceptical about the effectiveness of government policy and, you know, its ability to bring out really transformative, quick change. But the London Challenge was a great example of this. So London schools, you know, at the beginning of the new Labour era, were really the runt of the litter. They were the back of the pack, secondary schools and primary schools. And it was almost a cliche that wealthy families in the capital wanted to get their kids out to the home counties and to try and get them educated at that time. And so what New Labour did, in combination with investing, you know, massive amounts in schools, which we can't dismiss as a factor, they created this program, which was really, it wasn't that top down, really. It was creating a forum for schools to be able to share best practice. So schools that shared similar characteristics, so perhaps they had a large number of ethnic minority students, would be partnered together. The, you know, highly performing schools with schools that were lagging behind, so the schools that were performing well could share with the less effective schools what they'd learned and how they'd been so successful. And I think that's an incredibly effective tool, not only because because it meant that it could persevere, the policy could persevere through changes in the Department of Education, because it was essentially just providing the tools for schools to share their own knowledge, rather than dictating through a centralized process what exactly the school should be believing, and, you know, what the best practice was, which might change. One minister might have a different opinion to the previous minister. And effectively, it was just providing a forum, a basis for information sharing. But yeah, it was tremendously effective in London. London has now soared ahead of the rest of the nation. You're twice as likely to go to university if you're educated in London versus any other, versus the North of England, I should say, if you're on free school meals, which is an incredible advantage for the most deprived students. But unfortunately, it was only rolled out to the Greater Manchester and Black Country regions quite late on during the New Labour era. It showed some signs of being effective, but wasn't really run for long enough for us to see, you know, the massive benefits that we saw in London materialise in those parts of the country. And then when the coalition came in, you know, obviously it was austerity years, so we had harsh cutbacks to school budgets, and we also had the abandoning of the London Challenge programme, which I spoke to the founder, Tim Brighouse, and he was just, you know, tearing his hair out at the fact that this hugely successful policy, which actually wasn't, I say, wouldn't violate conservative principles massively, because it wasn't based on central government diktat. It was, you know, very much in terms of, you know, giving the tools to communities to solve their own problems. You know, you could see it in terms of community conservatism, which is something that Michael Gove, who took over as education secretary, you know, seems to believe in. But that wasn't the case. You know, he had his own ideas, and the policy was scrapped, unfortunately.
The next area is about social mobility and the fact that younger people seem to believe that they can have to move away to be socially mobile. You know, one of the great tragedies of our time, I think, is this lessening of social mobility. Certainly the belief that, you know, the future generation will be better off than the past previous generation, which in my family's case was very clear has happened, people in future will not have the same benefit of that.
Yeah, and I think this comes down quite largely to the housing crisis that we see, particularly in London, that it's this sort of perpetual battle between the jobs boards that you see online. You know, you can search in London and see, you know, 10 times, 20 times more job opportunities in the capital, and your eyes light up. You know, I've been there. You see the riches and you see the salaries and you think, wow, I can make it. You know, I can be more successful than my parents. And then you go on Rightmove, yeah, and you look at the rents and you're like, ah, that's why the wages are higher. And, you know, for the first few years of my career, am I going to be able to afford those rents? And also, I don't know London. You know, I've never lived there. It's a big place. It's different to anywhere else in the UK. You know, you hear stories of crime, and you hear stories of people who've gone down there and have just not been able to make friends and have been lonely in this huge city. And then you've got your parents who perhaps have a, I mean, my parents certainly do have even more antipathy towards the capital, because they see it as draining the resources of the rest of the country, and they don't want to see young people fleeing there. And as a result, people are pinned into where they've grown up, or they might go to the nearest sort of hub, which might be, you know, Leeds in my case, you know, close to Huddersfield, or Manchester, as I mentioned, or Newcastle. And that's great for those cities. And, you know, they've been regional success stories in recent years, but, you know, these small towns are still suffering and can't quite get their foot on the economic ladder. I think solving the housing crisis involves actually largely redistributing the economy to other parts of the country, which would benefit London and would help to you know, reduce the heat that we've seen in the London rental market that has boomed even after coronavirus. Like you say, it's London or bust to a large extent at the minute, which creates massive problems.
And linked to this, they all link together, of course, but linked to this is about health in places. And some of the most significant research I've seen on this, and you cover it in your book, is by Sir Michael Marmot. We've had him speak a number of times, and I still hope one day that Bristol will be one of his Marmot cities, because I think it's a great tool for moving a place forward. But we do have this issue, don't we, about declining quality of health and actually life expectancy now in places. I mean, some places have always had lower life expectancy than the wealthier places, but also within those places you have, you know, higher life expectancy, and then, you know, not so far away, much lower levels of life expectancy.
Yeah, and there's my friend Emma Dent Code, who was former Kensington MP, always tells me, you know, Kensington is the most unequal borough in the whole of the UK. You know, you've got the Stucho mansions of oligarchs next to Grenfell, and you've got life expectancy next to Harrods, for men living near Harrods at close to 90 years, and then you've got North Kensington, where the life expectancy, you know, is close to you know, mid to late 70s. So you've got a 20-year age gap nearly within Kensington itself. And so, yeah, there are massive internal health inequalities in the UK and also regionally, as you mentioned. I think, you know, you look at the Rust Belt of the United States, and obviously you see there the massive opioid epidemic, which is of a different magnitude to this country. But we've certainly got health problems that relate to economic decline, that relate to substance reliance, pollution. The northeast of England has astronomical rates of male suicide compared to other parts of the country. And I think that relates very directly to the economic position of certain former industrial places in the northeast over recent years. It's that sense of a lack of opportunity, as we just mentioned, you know, a lack of hope, you know, a sense of stagnation, a sense of not being able to break free of the circumstances in which you were born, and in fact going backwards and seeing, you know, your school friends leave and seeing your family die young. And as a result, that creates a mental health crisis, not just a physical health crisis in these places. And again, we've seen that during coronavirus. You know, coronavirus ripped through the places that are reliant on key workers, that, you know, where housing conditions are worse, where people are more likely to cohabit than not. And once again, I'm sure this will be borne out in the coronavirus inquiry, but Marmot, as you'll know, recommended in 2010 a series of reforms to improve the health of the nation and to rebalance these health inequalities. And he said in his report 10 years later in 2020 that we'd actually gone backwards, that austerity had very directly impacted the health of the poorest places in the country, while the southeast had got richer and had got healthier. And in a political sense, it's quite a conundrum, regardless of what you think about the political parties and where they stand at the minute. The fact is that austerity was the tool of one political party that caused certain poor areas of the country to get less healthy. And then those areas of the country voted for the party that had imposed that upon them. And when poorer people are essentially voting to be sicker, I think that's quite a dangerous situation, even though, you know, obviously it wasn't what they intended to vote for. It was effectively the consequence of voting for the austerity party.
What do you think about the argument about agglomeration, you know, where a big city, you know, clustering around it and has economic benefits? Do you think that, I mean, it certainly works in the case of London and the South East, there's no question about that. It probably works to certain respects in Bristol as well and the west of England. But what about places like Leeds and Manchester and Birmingham? Is this the way to go, to strengthen those places and have this beneficial impact elsewhere?
Yeah, I mean, we've got a dual problem in this country. You know, we don't like to make it easier for ourselves. We've got an overall productivity problem.
Yeah.
Obviously, we lag behind major European countries, in particular Germany. Germany is 10% more productive than us. But also Germany has less pronounced inequalities of productivity than we have. And so in order to increase overall productivity, you have to invest in these areas of agglomeration, because you're going to get the greatest benefits and the largest gains in the cities where you've got the highest skills that can really tap into our competitive advantages, which are, you know, it's the service economy. That's what we do now. But that's not necessarily going to fix the inequalities of productivity, because you want to invest in the small towns. The problem is that takes a lot more investment to improve those parts of the country than it does somewhere like Manchester. So I think you've got to try and do both if you can. I think to solve the overall productivity problem, you've got to incubate new sources of economic strength in cities. And then you've got to provide a new era of I don't want to say unskilled, because it isn't unskilled at all, but of vocational work in small towns that is secure, is well paid. But also you need to provide the connectivity to the cities to be able to ensure that those towns can benefit from the wealth growth of the likes of Manchester, Leeds, etc. I mean, our transport infrastructure, particularly in peripheral parts of the country, is woeful at the minute. And I think that we could massively reduce regional inequalities by improving that infrastructure. I mean, I was on a train line when I was younger that stretched from rural train line from Huddersfield to Sheffield. And if you took the full journey, which came once an hour, would take, you know, well over an hour. When if you did the journey by car, you'd be able to do it in comfortably under an hour between those two places. And if you fix that sort of problem, you'll create a great deal more social mobility, and you'll be able to extend the economic gains of cities to a much wider geographic area. I think, unfortunately, small towns and rural areas of the country exist in economic silos at the minute. And you can see why they've been stuck as a result.
Mm. I want to come back to some of the solutions in a moment. Just a couple of other big issues. We've talked about journalism. I mean, journalism, there's a number of issues, aren't there, beyond what we've talked about so far. The first is about the decline in local media, which means that it, you know, doesn't even get the coverage within the place itself that it deserves. And as a result, you've got, you know, journalists who don't get the right training to be able to move up into their own newspapers and actually go eventually to London. I think of someone like Harold Evans, you know, when he was editor of the Northern Echo and had worked on the Manchester Evening News, turned that into a major campaigning newspaper, a daily newspaper, and ended up as the great editor of the Sunday Times. But that's an issue that's gone. And then the second one is about the regional coverage of in the national press itself. And I thought it was very interesting recently that one of the finest regional journalists, I think, is Jennifer Williams, who was on the Manchester Evening News. She's now the Northern correspondent for the Financial Times. So a loss to Manchester in that way, though obviously keeps reporting the kind of stories she was interested in and covering at the time. But these are two significant problems, I think. You know, I can't think of many aspects of national press that I read where I think actually they've covered areas outside London adequately. John Harris on The Guardian, I suppose, is one example of that.
Yeah, it's few and far between, though. I mean, obviously one problem feeds the other, as you allude to, the lack of local reporters stepping up into national titles means that there's just not that expertise. There's just not the regional expertise. And as a result, it's not covered. It falls through the cracks. I think if you look at the regional terrain as well, the most effective and successful regional papers tend to be clustered around those successful cities in the north. So, you know, the Manchester Evening News, as you mentioned, the Liverpool Echo, the Yorkshire Post, which is, you know, obviously centered around Leeds to a certain degree. And it's those areas that are cut off economically that also have a desert of news. And so there's got to be, I think there's very little appetite, unfortunately, from the government to be able to fix this problem. Mm. You know, we're talking the day after one of the Conservative leadership postings where Liz Truss seemed to blame the media for Boris Johnson's downfall, which is quite a Trumpian approach and quite worrying to a large degree. But we've also seen a retrenchment of the national press in recent years, you know, a real decline in Fleet Street, the numbers of reporters on the beat in areas that you'd say are more social affairs, you know, crime, health, the sort of things that really do affect people across the country, and perhaps you'd say more acutely in areas outside of the southeast. They've declined and have been replaced by, you know, people covering more clickbait topics, you know, celebrity, because that's where the traffic is, and that's, you know, the newspapers are still heavily based on advertising income, and so advertising income has declined in recent years, and so you need to generate as many clicks as possible, and you know, those sort of nuts and bolts stories of hospitals and schools, etc., don't get the readership anymore. So we've seen a real, you know, in terms of just the basic policy coverage of the press, I think that's gone into free fall in recent years. And then you've got the political lobby, which is the dominant, you know, the front pages of the newspapers, which then feed into the coverage of the broadcasters, will be written by a lobby journalist pretty much every day. We saw during coronavirus, the questions to the medical officers and the prime minister were led by lobby journalists, political journalists, rather than specialist health reporters, which I think was one of the reasons why the coverage perhaps wasn't as nuanced as it should have been during that crisis. And of course, lobby journalists, you know, the name of the lobby stems from literally the place in the Palace of Westminster that these journalists are allowed to access to interview MPs and speak to their advisors, etc. So it is hyper London focused. It's not just, you know, in the capital, it's in this sort of enclave of the capital, this, you know, political heartland that is very much separated from the experiences of the rest of the country. And so it's a very acute problem that we've got in the media at the minute.
I mean, I'm very impressed with the Yorkshire Post at the moment and the kind of old fashioned campaigning zeal of the editor, you know, who's very active, and also the way that a number of all the northern papers got together to campaign for certain things. You know, the same similar front pages on each of them on particular themes. I was very impressed with that, and I have to say I was encouraged by when I went back for family reasons to Wolverhampton, and I picked up a copy of the Express and Star, which still seemed to cover much more than I thought a local paper at this current time would be able to cover. I was much encouraged by that. But generally, it has been this decline, which has led to all sorts of problems. Another problem is devolution and the way that this has turned out. You know, Blair and Prescott stopped their work on it when the Tyneside proposal failed. Only Bristol voted in favour when Cameron wanted to introduce the city mayors. I actually heard him speak at one of the events on this when he talked about once the referendums in the different cities were over, he would chair a committee of the mayors. That was rapidly dropped when only Bristol wanted it and the rest had been appointed by their councils. So devolution is a bit of a dog's breakfast, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's a quite messy patchwork at the minute. And the government seems to want to rapidly fill in the blank bits of the country that aren't covered by the current devolution settlement. And I think that is the right approach. I think there's still a balance to be struck, as we've seen in Bristol recently, between hearing the views of local people and making sure they have a devolution settlement that they're happy with, that they're, you know, that they have a democratic input, but also ensuring that local opinion doesn't stymie the powers that you know we're attempting to give to regions. I think the big problem that we have currently is we'll see when that patchwork is filled in, the natural inequalities of the country come to the fore again. You know, Greater Manchester and the West Midlands are clearly, you know, miles ahead in terms of the powers that they have. And you don't see that changing, you know, even when Cornwall gets its agreement, when obviously North Yorkshire is going to get its. You know, Manchester and Birmingham are powerful economically, and devolution doesn't do anything really to redress that balance. So I'm very worried that we'll still have, you know, the London mayor that will be, you know, governing a place of 10 million people, and then you'll have a couple of others that will govern major cities and will have clout in the national media. And then you'll have a patchwork of others that will represent actually relatively small populations with more limited powers. And you're just essentially institutionalizing the regional inequalities that we already have. I think filling in the map of the country in terms of this current devolution agreement is good. You know, I wouldn't like to see us change again, because I think it will take us another 30 years to get to the place that we are currently. But once we've filled in the map with, you know, city, region, areas, etc., I'd like to see a top layer, you know, another layer of devolution added, whereby, you know, broader regions, you know, across the southwest, for example, or across the north, can come together in a democratic process to legislate for a wider geographic area, and can solve problems that otherwise would be reserved to head the, you know, head honchos in Manchester and Birmingham, etc. Otherwise, I think that the democratic settlement in this country will be quite weak compared to Germany, for example, which has a much more effective system of regional governments.
And that was a point I wanted to come on to in the book, which is about who does this better. And you give the example of Germany, and I've long been impressed by what Germany has done, obviously since the Second World War, when things began to change substantially, and they do have more powerful regions. They do have powerful regional leaders. But they've also spent a lot of money over many decades. It's been the work of decades, not a parliamentary term, hasn't it?
No, exactly. For two reasons, this is sort of built into the German psyche and into the constitutional settlement. Obviously, the post-war era, there was an appetite and a need for Germany to be decentralized so that we didn't see a repeat of the authoritarianism of dictatorship, Nazism, etc. And ironically, it was British lawyers that helped to frame that constitution, that devolved constitution in the post-war era. And then obviously with the fall of the Berlin Wall, we've had over the past 30 years a deep ingrained sense that the country needed to be unified. And the way to do that was to rebalance geographically east and west. And so that's been a concern of all parties. That's not something that's up for debate. It's not a political tool in the same way that it is this country. And, you know, I've spoken to Lisa Nandy, who heads up Labour's Levelling Up work, and she says that she wants to create the same sort of ethos in this country where it's ingrained. I think Brexit could have been our moment of sort of national acceptance of this as a formative inequality that transcends party politics. But Brexit was just so polarizing that the campaign for regional equality is now quite heavily associated with a certain part of politics. And so I think the left, to some degree, despite it being irrational for them to believe this, they're quite hesitant about tackling regional inequalities, despite the fact that the left is you know, set up to address injustices and inequalities, particularly economic ones. And so I think we're still in a place where we haven't made this a national mission. We'll see what the next prime minister does.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, Gordon Brown's heading up this constitutional review at the moment for Labour, isn't he? And I do hope that will look at not just the devolution work and powers and, you know, the role of mayors and local authorities, but also at wider issues like proportional representation, we'll come on to some of these in a moment, but like reforming the way government operates centrally, even where it's placed. Do you have any hopes that Labour will do that?
I'm not sure. I having any sort of hope where the Labour Party is concerned is quite dangerous at the minute. But, you know, you've always got to have that lingering sense that eventually they will get their act together. But I think, you know, I think there are two different wings of the Labour Party at the minute where this is concerned. There's the central office, which is actually quite conservative where these issues are concerned. I'd say that they probably won't go that far beyond what the Conservatives are proposing in terms of devolution. I mean, that was one thing that was praised in the Levelling Up white paper and subsequently in the Queen's speech, the scale of the ambition from the government where devolution is concerned and really accelerating these regional, these city region deals. So I don't think Labour has much space to go that far beyond. So that's certainly the approach of Nandy and Starmer. And then on the other wing, you've got the likes of Burnham, Clive Lewis, who's obviously down in Norwich, who believe fundamentally that we need constitutional reform in this country, both to fix the democratic constitutional issues that we've seen in recent months, but also to award greater powers to the nations and regions. You know, Burnham, I think, perhaps for the first time in my book, said that he'd like to see the House of Lords abolished and replaced with a Senate of the Nations and Regions alongside proportional representation in the House of Commons. So, and that's obviously very much an approach of Clive Lewis, who's spearheaded the proportional representation campaign. I'd say that's probably a step too far currently for the Labour leadership, despite the fact that Starmer did the lead on these sort of ideas in his leadership campaign. So maybe, you know, the next iteration of the Labour Party will see this as the way to fix the problem. But for the minute, I'd say that the Labour Party wants to continue the devolution settlement that we've seen from the Conservatives, on top of greater investment in public services, and, you know, more effective investment, and certainly more equitable investment, through levelling up, you know, not just piling money into Tunbridge Wells.
Another, as came up recently in the Conservative Party election campaign.
Yeah, exactly. Rishi Sunak boasting that he'd changed the funding formula to give the leafy Tory shires more money, as opposed to what New Labour did, which was obviously such a shocking policy of putting money into deprived urban areas as though they need any money.
Well, one other country you point to where there have been improvements in recent years in this is France. And I was quite interested in the Minister for Territorial Development and Cohesion that's there. And also that the way the Prime Minister meets in a national conference of the territories, I think every 7 years, to agree priorities with the state.
Well, exactly. You know, France is in quite a similar position to us in terms of its regional inequalities. It has an all-powerful urban centre in Paris, and marginalised, quite, you know, demographically old and white rural farming areas that have actually been inclined towards Marine Le Pen and the far right in recent years. And there is, you know, I think probably because of France's constitutional settlement and the fact that it has more flexibility in its republic than we do in our system. You know, we're quite hamstrung through, you know, merely being able to operate through the House of Commons system, that France does have these mechanisms to listen to the regions and to try and implement some sort of coherent regional agenda. But even then, I mean, this is the scale of the problem, and it's why I'm not hugely optimistic, unfortunately, about, you know, fixing these problems anytime soon, in that France has vast regional inequalities. I think the inequalities between Paris and the rest of France are only marginally better than the inequalities between London and the rest of the UK. I'd say that France, perhaps due to its size and particularly its transport links, its improved transport links versus the UK, perhaps has more a greater number of powerful cities than we do. But it is really still stuck in a bind that the UK is in as well.
Moving forward, you've talked about some of the proposals in the book. There's little point tinkering around, isn't there? You know, you talk about, you know, it's not a question of a few extra train stations, more police officers and hospitals. It's about fundamental change. Mm. And that's at a number of levels. And I just wanted to talk about a few of those. The first is about how we pay for this. And, you know, Germany has this, the solidarity tax, which was introduced after reunification, to pay for reunification and other things. And it's quite a substantial amount of money, isn't it? I mean, it's something like 5.5% currently, I think, of the of someone's additional to income tax that people pay.
Yeah, exactly. It's widely accepted. I don't, I mean, this is the question about sort of the national attitude towards this problem, that allows that sort of taxation to happen in Germany in a way that, unfortunately, I just don't think that it could in this country. And I think left behind, more deprived areas of the country would actually resent being the recipient of a surcharge, because they, you know, I mean, I'll speak from a northern perspective primarily here, but, you know, we're quite proud, you know, we don't need any of your money, sort of attitude. So I don't think that would work in terms of just lifting the German model. But I think certainly earmarking pots of money from taxation of, you know, the landlord economy in London, the inflation of property prices down there, obviously the high end industries that operate primarily in the city of London, in the square mile of London, trying to levy more aggressive taxation, as has been talked about, you know, for the, you know, since the Ed Miliband era of, you know, wealth taxes, land taxes, etc., to then earmark and channel back through, you know, not in a crude way, you know, in the way that it operates in Germany, but just through the natural operation of tax and spend, you know, to put booster rockets on national investment schemes, you know, in railways, in regional investment banks, in universities, academic institutions, scientific hubs. And I think the Oxford, Cambridge, London sort of triangle is actually a really good model where this is concerned, because Oxford and Cambridge aren't particularly large, but they've got, you know, highly skilled specialisms that deliver high wage work, academic institutions that feed these powerhouses of industry, these new powerhouses of industry in those local areas. And I guess the question is, you know, what competitive advantage do northern areas have? I mean, the vaccine, a lot of the vaccine development took place in the northeast of England. Still, we've still got great chemical and scientific expertise up in the northeast. As I mentioned in the book that you'll have seen, you know, I think Durham University is one of the great wastes. Unfortunately, you know, you have a vast many highly skilled graduates from Durham that unfortunately just flee down south every year after they've graduated. You know, how do we retain some of those people in, you know, in high wage, high skilled employment, while, like, frankly, giving them the benefits of lower housing costs in the northeast? And I think people would relish that, particularly if they could go and live in, work near Newcastle, which, you know, provides the cultural benefits similar to that of living in London. You know, there's, you know, you can have a great night out in Newcastle. You know, I think that sort of model is what we need to concentrate on. But like you say, I think it's fundamental. I think it relies on political change. I think it relies on being a lot more ambitious in terms of the scale of the money that we want to raise and spend on levelling up. And you know, one of the proposals that I've put forward is to move Parliament out of London, because I think that would be a symbolic act from our political leaders to say, you know, we take regional inequality seriously, we want to be more connected to the people, we think that Westminster has become a bubble, etc., etc. But also practically, you'd get, you know, vast numbers of civil servants, of journalists, of businesses that rely on contracts from the government would move along with the institutions of power, that would actually create a big bang moment, I think, where regional equality is concerned. Obviously, there are a vast number of challenges, not least that it will never be implemented by a government because it, you know, MPs are far too ingrained in the capital. But, you know, it's that scale of thinking that I think we've got to come to terms with, rather than, yeah, just tinkering around the edges.
And that big political change is like reforming the House of Lords, making it an elected Senate of nations and regions. Even the idea of moving Parliament out of London, yes, it's unlikely to happen, but there's no better time at the moment to do that, given that they're going to spend billions of pounds refurbishing the Palace of Westminster.
Well, exactly. I mean, you think about the cost of it, which is astronomical. So I think the lower end of the cost estimates are around £10 billion. And the national insurance hike that has been put on all our wage packets recently amounts to £12 billion worth of income for the government every year. So that shows the scale of the investment that's needed. I mean, I borrow from, I think, a very good idea from Danny Dorling, which suggests that Downing Street should be turned into a boutique hotel. And we could sell off Whitehall real estate for a vast amount of money and, you know, spend liberally in some other parts of the country. Mm-hmm. And at least we know it's got a big enough wine fridge. So, you know, I think, like you say, I think this is the perfect opportunity to do it. Obviously, there were suggestions about the House of Lords moving to York, which I thought would have been a very good idea. Although you won't really want to separate the institutions of power, at least it would have been some symbolic it would have been some symbolic action, but it did feel as though that was slightly a threat to the House of Lords that were sort of jostling about Brexit, and that Boris Johnson was saying, "Oh, if you're not careful, we'll send you up north." So yeah, it doesn't look like it's going to happen, but if only it would.
Yeah, and the final area is about the economy, and you talk in the book about the foundational economy and strengthening that. Just tell us about that.
Yeah, so the foundational economy is, it sounds quite novel, because the way in which economics is traditionally framed is looking at the industries in which you produce highest growth in terms of, you know, your inputs to GDP, and those tend to be, you know, high-end services, financial industries, technology, etc. And a lot of government attention goes towards sort of creating, you know, the next giants of big tech, you know, wanting to create a British Apple or whatever. And as a result, we have an immense amount of speculative spending in the Western world in general on sort of technological high-end service development. Meanwhile, over the past 12 years, particularly in this country, obviously, we've seen pay restraint in public services. And the foundational economy essentially posits that if you improve the material circumstances of those key workers, essentially, as we've come to know them, and the industries, the public services in which they work, and this isn't necessarily to say that they're all public services, you know, the foundational economy is basically the services that sustain the basic elements of public life, and many of which are privately owned. But if we improve the circumstances of the people working in those industries and the operation of those services, you're actually increasing the material wealth of the population of roughly half of the population. And that's, you know, I think a core issue in the current cost of living crisis, in that, and particularly the question of strikes at the minute, in that we're looming towards a recession, but we've also got inflation. So some people have suggested that we need another, you know, we need to hold down wage growth. When, you know, the best way to guarantee that we won't go into recession and we'll come out of this stronger as a nation and with less poverty is to ensure the wage growth of particularly public sector workers and those in the middle to lower end of the wage spectrum, because those are the people who you know, won't pocket the overwhelming majority of their income, won't send it offshore, won't cause the housing crisis to worsen. They will spend it. They will spend it in their shops. They'll spend it in their supermarkets. They'll spend it in local independent stores. And the health of the nation will improve immeasurably. Unfortunately, at the minute, the sort of traditional economic thinking is quite abstract and thinks of things only in terms of raw GDP growth, rather than who are we actually growing the economy for, who is benefiting. And, you know, as you know, I'm particularly concerned about which areas of the country.
Essentially, that we need to think long term, and this is the work of decades. It's a bit like Germany and the approach they had. How do we make this happen in terms of getting beyond the kind of electoral cycles of 4 to 5 years, or even shorter in recent experience, and, you know, company bottom lines, which increasingly are, you know, quarterly and not even annually anymore?
Well, exactly. Yeah, this is a political crisis combined with a corporate crisis. Like you say, you know, the terms of CEOs in big corporations at the minute are incredibly short. You know, financial institutions make a lot of money, not through investment, but merely through swapping cash, you know, moving cash around the system and taking a margin. So I think there's got to be regulatory reform. And the likes of Richard Murphy have talked that, you know, greater, you know, more knowledgeable than I am about these sort of things. But certainly incentivizing through national investment banks long-term investment from commercial institutions that were traditionally just, you know, exploit and look for short-term gains over you know, long-term investments. I think he suggested created a national investment bond or something like that would allow those institutions to put their money in, have a guaranteed return, that would then be invested into the development of critical infrastructure in the country. And that seems a tweak. That, I mean, the fortunate thing about financial services is that, as I say, that the problem is that they're quite abstract in an economic sense, but because they are abstract, they can move quickly, and we can also regulate them quite quickly. And I think that would be a natural move for the next Labour government to do. So on a commercial level, I think that those sort of changes, those sort of tweaks would make sense alongside, you know, the political reform that we've talked about, and creating a constitutional settlement that extends devolution across the country, creates regional institutions of power that are strong, that have national clout, institutionalizing that within within the Westminster system or within the traditional parliamentary system. Like I say, I think a council of the regions is a brilliant idea. I think that would naturally gain media attention. You'd have Andy Burnham, you know, and Andy Street. You'd have Dan Jarvis, whoever the new mayor of North Yorkshire is, all clustering together at one moment. And if you had national leaders joining along there, it would look quite similar to the French model of, you know, this sort of 7-year cycle of listening to the regions and their interests, where, you know, you could thrash out the agenda, and this could become a national moment of debate that could, you know, happen on, you know, maybe a 2-year, 3-year basis, that would then institutionalize this idea that we're going to do this, you know, regardless of the political party that's in power. This is a national mission. And to a large extent, the mayors are very good at that. You know, there's a great amount of collaboration between the Conservative mayors and the Labour mayors. And, you know, I was struck actually between, you know, the collaboration between the likes of Steve Rotherham in Liverpool, learning from Andy Street, who's a Conservative. Mm. You know, Steve Rotherham's, you know, he's a Corbyn acolyte. Mm. And he's learning off Andy Street in the West Midlands. And that's great. That's really, you know, they're doing what's effective, not what's ideological. And the more that we can institutionalize this, I think it's really about baking it into the structures of how our democracy operates, either through, you know, the House of Lords and how the House of Commons operates, or through, you know, other sort of mechanisms and forums for conversation and policymaking. That's what we've got to do. We can't just rely, I think, on the goodwill of people to see this change through. It's got to be fundamental structural reform.
And these changes would be good for London too, wouldn't they?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think, you know, London is I include myself here as someone who lives in London, you know, desperate to see their, you know, their housing costs reduce. And that will be a natural consequence, albeit a long-term one, of regional rebalancing. There's often, there has been the accusation leveled at me about this book, and I think fortunately it's usually from people who haven't read it. who say that, oh, you're trying to chop off the tallest tree. And I'm saying no. So I want London to grow. I'm not saying that I don't want London to grow and that we want to sort of pilfer London's riches. That's not what I'm saying at all. What I'm saying is, wouldn't it be to the benefit of London if London's overall growth, whether that's GDP, income levels for the richest, etc., if they grow more modestly than they have in the past, but other problems that the capital has, particularly housing, are alleviated. So if the incomes of ordinary Londoners grow modestly, perhaps more modestly than they did in the past, but housing costs reduce or stagnate, or, you know, there's at least a period of relief, ordinary Londoners will get richer, they will get wealthier. And so I think once that is explained actually to Londoners, they totally get it. And I think that's one of the big problems that we have about the regional conversation at the minute. It feels as though lots of people are pointing fingers at London. London's to blame, Londoners are to blame for this problem. And what I'm saying in my book is that London itself needs to be saved from the capital. It needs to be saved from the system that the capital has created, where, you know, you've got rampant exploitative landlordism. You know, you've got massive wage growth in a few high-end sectors. You've got gentrification, and you've got the highest poverty rates in the country. And regional rebalancing would solve that as much as it solves the problems of the Red Wall. And it's about recognizing, and hopefully, I think the Labour Party has a large role to play in this. Is making people realise that this is a national mission that includes London, doesn't exclude London.
Well, Fortress London is published by Harper North, which is part of HarperCollins. That's itself an interesting example of a publisher moving out of the capital, and at least as a number of other publishers are, including in moving to Bristol, setting up regional offices.
Yeah, exactly. And full credit to HarperCollins for initiating Harper North. And they like to say to me, it's not a project. It's not, you know, it's a new division entirely of HarperCollins. You know, with its own editorial freedom to commission the books it wants to commission, including, you know, mine. And obviously it published Brian Groom's tremendous history of the North of England recently, which is the sort of book that you wouldn't see on your bookshelves traditionally. So, you know, all power to them. And yeah, hopefully it provides an example for more institutions I think this is a big problem, actually. A big economic problem is that we've got talent in some parts of the country that isn't being fully utilized because people simply can't access the capital. And, you know, I think I was told this by a journalist that if the BBC moved certain programs up north, they'd have a lack of talent. And I was, you know, tearing my hair out and thinking, no, there are dozens of, you know, of young journalists who, you know, could serve those flagship programs in the North of England. They're just not given the opportunities to do so. And, you know, hopefully that'll be a more prominent feature of public life in years to come.
Well, thank you, Sam. The book, full of ideas. We do urge you to read it, and it deserves wide debate. We'll certainly be returning to this theme in our work. And in October 2023, when we run our next Festival of the Future City, Sam, we hope you'll be able to come to Bristol and join us for those debates there. As mentioned, Fortress London is out now from Harper North, and we do encourage you to read it. Thank you for joining us, Sam.
Thanks, Andrew.